Let's imagine you just moved into your new place and you just started drilling holes into your walls in order to hang up your important pictures or something similar. Everything is going according to plan, but before drilling the last hole, you realize something. This hole lies right between an outlet and your home distribution box. So in theory, there is a possibility that a wire is running through the wall there. So by simply drilling, you can create a short circuit and damage your house wiring permanently. Thankfully though, I live in Germany, and we have standards on where the wires should be positioned inside a wall, so I can drill without any worries. But that is of course not the case for all countries in the world. A solution to this problem could be such a cable tracker, which I got from eBay for pretty cheap. To use it, I firstly have to turn off the mains power with the help of the matching fuse. Then I can push a plug into the outlet whose L and PE wire I hook up to the cable tracker, whose power switch I flip on to the tone modes. Last but not least, I need to hold the cable tracker receiver push button in order to activate it. And as you can see and hear, whenever I come close to the wires in the wall, the received tone of the cable tracker becomes louder. Of course, it is not 100% precise, but this way you can still pretty easily track the wires in your wall, which is not only useful when hanging pictures, but also when you got a fault in your wiring and you need to find out where it is located. I personally think this product is pretty handy to have around. Which is why in this episode of DIY or Buy, I will not only reverse engineer the circuits of this tool and explain how they work, but I will also show you how to create a super crude DIY version that you can make within 15 minutes. And at the end, I will decide which version I recommend you to use. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB. Feel free to visit their website jlcpcb.com to not only find out what awesome PCB and assembly services they offer, but also to easily upload your Gerber files and thus order affordable and high quality PCBs quickly. Firstly, let's talk about the general functional principle of this tool. By hooking up the sender to a pair of wires, it basically sends a special voltage waveform through them, and thus turns them into antennas, which broadcast this waveform through the air. Now the receiver uses its own antenna to pick this waveform up, and plays it back on a small speaker. Of course, the closer you get to the wires, the more the receiver will pick up. And just like that, you should now understand the simplified functional principle of this cable tracker. To dig deeper though, we can firstly hook up the sender to the oscilloscope to see the waveform for ourselves. As you can see, it resembles a square wave, but with big voltage peaks at the edges. And its frequency also seems to vary over time, between values of around 1 kHz to 1.14 kHz. Which explains the changing tone the receiver plays back. But of course, to build a DIY version of such a sender, we should probably understand how the circuit works, for which I opened up its housing. I was not only rather surprised how simple it was to take everything apart, but also that the circuit traces were easy to see and the name of the IC was not removed. Which basically means this should be easy to reverse engineer. So I firstly googled the name of the IC, in order to not only find out that it is a hex inverter IC, but also that it comes with this pinout. Next, I followed the traces leading from and to the IC, in order to create a crude schematic of what we are working with. At some point I also had to use my multimeter with its continuity function. But overall, like previously stated, this circuit was pretty straightforward to reverse engineer. But that does not mean that the circuit itself is easy to understand, which you might agree with while looking at this finalized schematic. The first thing that came to my mind while seeing this was a ring oscillator. To create one, you have to put an odd number of inverter stages in series, with the last one feeding back into the first, which creates a square wave on the output. The reason why this works is pretty simple to explain. Let's imagine the last inverter output is low, which means the first output gets pulled high, and thus the next one gets pulled low, and the last one therefore pulled high, which makes the first one gets pulled low. This cycle repeats over and over again, creating a square wave, whose on and off time is dependent on the turn on slash off times of the IC, and also by what kind of resistors and capacitors you add to the mix. Now the sender circuit seems to be a special kind of ring oscillator, that features a changing frequency. But for my own crude DIY solution, we can build something way simpler. All we need is such a Schmidt trigger hex inverter IC, along with one microfarad capacitor and one 50 kilo ohm potentiometer. After connecting the parts to one another on a breadboard, according to this minimalistic schematic, we can hook up 5 volt power and have a look at the outputs on the oscilloscope. As you can see, it creates a square wave signal, whose frequency we can fine-tune with the potentiometer. And if you're now interested in how such a relaxation oscillator functions, then make sure to watch my basics video about Schmidt triggers. But anyway, by bringing the turned on receiver close to the output of the circuit, you can hear that it picks up the sent out waveforms without any problems. Of course, we do not have the changing tone, but I would say that the frequency of around 3 kHz is much more noticeable and annoying than any changing tone. That means that the DIY sender is done and works, and thus it was time to open up the receiver and have a closer look at it as well. Once again, these circuit traces were clearly visible, and it seems like the only IC used is an LM386 audio power amplifier. So once again, time to reverse engineer the circuit, which this time was quicker to do and the end result was also easier to understand. Simplified speaking, the received signal through the antenna controls the gate of a transistor, which preamplifies the received signal, as you can see here on the oscilloscope. This signal is then fed into the audio amplifier, which obviously amplifies the signal and connects it to a speaker for playback. I have to say that this circuit is already pretty minimalistic, but I wanted to go with even less components for my DIY circuit. It basically does the same thing as the bi-receiver circuit, by firstly pre-amplifying the antenna signal and then amplifying it again through the help of an op-amp, which playbacks the received tone through headphones. So it was time to create the circuit, for which I did not use the breadboards due to existing parasitic capacitances, but instead I soldered everything to one another in mid-air. As soon as my piece of art was complete, I powered it up with 9 volts. And as you can hear, this circuit seems to work just fine as well. But next time I should probably use a more powerful op-amp to get a louder tone output. Anyway though, with the testing being completed, my DIY cable tracker was complete. But I really did not bother creating proper housings for it, because I think that for a price of just $13, the buy version is really worth its price tag, and you should for the most part stick with it. That does not mean that buy is the winner though, because if you want to go super cheap or need a cable tracker in just 15 minutes, then DIY is definitely the way to go. Which is why for me both DIY and buy are this time the winner. But what do you think? Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. As always, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe and hit the notification bell. Stay creative and I will see you next time!